Belgravia is the latest offering from Julian Fellowes, the creator of Downton Abbey. If you watch our show at all, you'll know that I'm a huge fan of Downton Abbey. I consider the writing, the acting, and the production values to be some of the finest I've ever seen on television. When it finished its run, it left a huge void in the television landscape. And channels like PBS have been trying to fill that void ever since, in touting one period piece after another as the next Downton Abbey. And those are unfair comparisons. Those shows aren't Downton Abbey, they're very different. And of course, when Belgravia was announced and Julian Fellowes was the creator and his creative team was also going to be working on Belgravia, everyone started saying, here's the next Downton Abbey, and that's unfair. Belgravia is a good series in and of itself, and it should be judged on its own merits. It's a very, very different story than Downton Abbey. Downton Abbey was an upstairs-downstairs story. We followed servants in a great house working for nobility in the English society. And we came to know and like the characters both in the upstairs and downstairs aspects of that story. They were mutually respectful of one another, and their stories played out over time. It was lightning in a bottle. Belgravia is very different. It takes place many years before the events in Downton Abbey. We actually start in 1815 on the eve of the Battle of Waterloo, a couple days before. We're at a ball where the elite society is going for the evening to the Earl and Countess of Brockenhurst's home. And their son, Edward Bellasis, is a soldier and he's going to be at this party. He has secured an invite for a girl of society, but not born into society, who he's fallen in love with. And her name is Sophia Trenchard. Her family is not old money, they are new money. Her father made his fortune and worked his way up to be a part of society. But they are looked down upon because they are not old money with inherited titles that they were born into. Sophia's mother is very cautious. Anne Trenchard warns her daughter that she is trying to step above her place in society and she will only get hurt. But Sophia is in love with Edward, and it appears that Edward is in love with her, and so she plunges forward. By the end of this evening, the soldiers are called away because Napoleon is on the march and they have to meet the threat. And as Sophia and her mother leave the ball, Sophia sees something that immediately upsets her. And we're not sure why or what it is, and we will eventually find out because it's a mystery that's going to unravel as the series progresses. We move 25 years forward at this point into 1840, and we find out that Sophia has passed away in childbirth prior to this, and she gave birth to Edward's son. And they gave that little boy away in order to protect Sophia's good name. And I don't want to give any more of the plot at this point, because I'm hoping that you will check the series out, and for me to say any more would kind of destroy your enjoyment of watching the show. I want to tell you that it is very different than Downton Abbey. In Downton Abbey, the servants were a major part of the story, not just because of their plot aspects, but because we cared about their characters. While we do have servants in this story, they basically serve the plot. They're not necessarily likable people. They do things very often for their own well-being and often in hurtful ways to their employers. They do things that will hurt their employers in order to benefit themselves. So they're we are looking at the servant class in a very different light in this series than we were before. In Downton Abbey, we didn't have a resident villain per se. We had people who would visit the characters that we had come to know, and they might do something that would be hurtful to those characters, and certainly the effects of their actions would be felt through several episodes, but those villainous characters weren't regulars and weren't a permanent part of the Downton Abbey landscape. Here we have a definite villain. His name is John Bellasis, and he's Edward's cousin. And whereas Edward was to inherit the title of Earl of Brockenhurst, John will now inherit that title. He's lazy, he's pompous, he feels that he deserves whatever he can get without working for it, and he plays the part so well that you like him and hate him at the same time. I like his performance, I hate his character. So he's an inherent villain throughout the piece, and he puts a lot of the plot in motion by his actions. His parents, Stephen and Anne Bellasys, his father is a minister, but he has a gambling problem and gambles all the money away. His mother is likable enough, we don't see her very often, and she's at the mercy of the two men in her life. And then we, of course, see the Earl and Countess of Brockenhurst and how their story re-entwines with the story of the Trenchards throughout these six episodes. This is a much shorter series than Downton Abbey. There is some talk of a season two, although this series has a definite beginning, a definite middle, and a definite end. They do leave enough threads in play that there could be a season two, but if there isn't one, this is a nice six-episode diversion. It plays very much like a mini-series. And speaking of mini-series, this does have some similarities to the John Jakes North and South series that was made into a mini-series back in the 1980s on American television. Especially the Trenchard's younger son, Oliver, has a wife, Susan, who is very much like Ashton Maine from the North and South series. And John Bellasys very much plays a little bit like Elkanah Bent, if not some of the other characters that were introduced by Jakes. Also, the time period is similar. While we're about 20 years prior to the American Civil War, society is very, very similar at that time. And I think it has some, you know, definite feel to it of the time period of North and South. In addition, there's a little bit of Count of Monte Cristo going on here because there's some hidden identities and some things that we're waiting to get exposed, and we're hoping that it comes out in a certain way and it comes out in time that our characters, especially the ones that we're rooting for, will benefit from that information being exposed. And there is a question as to whether it ever will come out, all the truth will ever come out or not. So it does keep you hanging. I don't think it's necessarily predictable. I'm sure that as I know for myself, as I watched it, there was an ending that I certainly wanted to see, and I wasn't sure I was going to get that ending, and I won't let you know if I did. You're gonna have to check it out yourself to find out. But let me tell you, do not compare it to Downton Abbey. If Belgravia had come out before Downton Abbey, it would have been successful and there would have been no question about it. The fact that it's got to come on the coattails of Downton Abbey is definitely a handicap that the series will have to deal with, because people will compare it, and it's an unfair comparison. This is its own series, it's its own story, it has its own good characters, and it really deserves to be checked out, especially if you did like Downton Abbey. I cannot guarantee that you will like this, but if you give it a chance, I think you might enjoy it. So for me, definitely a see it.